Today I would like to talk about a couple of very interesting reports which have been issued this week. And that's in the context of the role of the United Nations organization. We know that as far as the modern society is concerned, the existence of this organization is considered to be one of the biggest achievements, where all the countries of the world have come together, became member of that. Now, whether they have succeeded in the role and the goal of having United Nations organization or not is something debatable, especially when we look at, you know, the whole purpose was that the countries would be able to sit down and resolve the dispute peacefully without, you know, going to war. But that has not really happened. So there is a failure on that, you know, dimension of UN. But one of the fundamental flaws with that organization is this lack of equality among those who are known as the permanent members of the Security Council and the rest of the members of the UNO. You know, one of the Urdu poet described it, that UNO means, you know, you know, United States and the rest of the world is no. And when we look at this, you know, sometimes we think maybe this is true, because all those countries who do not follow the line of the superpower, they're always brought to trial. They're brought to the table, and the whole book of international laws is open. They are condemned, they are intimidated with the threat of war, military force, and everything is done in the name of the international community, this magical word, you know, as if it justifies whatever they want to do. The report which has been, you know, issued on Tuesday of this week by Human Rights Watch, as well as by Amnesty International, about the US strikes by drones in Yemen and Pakistan, are very, you know, interesting to read, especially when they talk about the number of innocent civilians killed in that process of hunting the terrorists. You know, and this has been echoed by the special reporter of the United Nations, Ben Emerson, who described last week that there is an urgent need for greater disclosure concerning these aerial strikes. And this is going to be debated today at the United Nations General Assembly. The report by Human Rights Watch investigated only 6 strikes in Yemen, where they found that 82 people were killed in those 6 strikes in Yemen. And out of 82 people killed, 57 were civilians. So you can look at the ratio that, you know, in trying to hunt out, you know, the terrorists, you are actually killing many, many more civilians. Amnesty International report focuses on Pakistan, especially just one last year, where 45 drone strikes took place. And they actually have classified some of the strikes, they have dubbed them as rescuer attacks. Means once a missile will be, you know, targeted in an area, and some people will be killed, others will now come to rescue those who are wounded. Then they will come again and, you know, send their missiles to those who have come to rescue them. It's very much like what we see, you know, many of these terrorists are doing in Pakistan as well as in Iraq. That, you know, one explosion happens at a place, and then when the ambulance and the medical and emergency personnel and people come to help, you know, after 5 minutes or so, another explosion takes place. And this is where, you know, according to the words of United Nations Special Rapporteur, he says he has accused U.S. of violating international laws. And this is where we realize that, you know, U.S. has lost whatever ground it had to lecture the rest of the world about international law, especially when we see, you know, their own conduct. even with their allies in Europe. First, we had this whole issue of, you know, spying on the telephones of the citizens of Europe, and now we see about, you know, even spying on the phones of the leaders of those countries. And this is where, just yesterday, the leader of German, the remark she made was, we are allies, but an alliance can only be built on trust. That's why I repeat again, spying among friends, that cannot be. And so, you know, before US goes around asking, especially those who are considered to be their adversaries, to prove their honesty in what they are saying, you know, and to take steps which will gain US trust, US has first to build its own trust among its allies and then the rest of the world. And this is where I come to this ayat of Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهِ. They do their own makr, their own planning, you know, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala plans in his own ways. وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. Nobody can, you know, compete with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to planning. And this is where we have to ask, who is, you know, isolated these days? Is it Iran or other countries, or is it the United States of America? And this is where we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works in his own mysterious ways. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give more, you know, wisdom to the people, to open up their eyes and to understand the realities of what is going on in the world. إن أحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المظلمين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم. For the second khutbah, I have two items here. First is just a very simple explanation about a question that I've been getting from quite a few individuals. When we started this year's school year with the students sitting there in the middle area all together, and the question was about the connection for the adults who are behind. First of all, you know, the connection was always there through the side there, through the adults. Number two, it's, you know, I talked about it before, but there's nothing wrong in reminding people about it. When it comes to the connection in namaz, in salat, of jama'at, the condition is not bulugh. For you to be connected with the other person through the, you know, with other lines of namaz of jama'at, it is not necessary that the person through whom you are being connected should be baligh. He could be a non-baligh child, but as long as the child is mumayyiz. Mumayyiz means those who know how to do the namaz. They know the, you know, the akhlaq and the method of namaz. If they can do that, you know, they are sufficient connection between you and the other sufuf of the salat. And so that's one thing. Today we have changed slightly, and that is because of another issue, nothing to do with the connection. just to make sure they are not sitting all together. You know, there is more chances of, you know, lack of discipline there. So we are going back to the normal method of having one student and one adult in between, you know, after them. And so we hope that, you know, everybody understands that. There is nothing to be concerned about it. If that would have been a concern, I would have been the first one to point it out. Trust me at least on that issue. Salawat Mandekara. This is the week of Ghadir. We just celebrated the Eid of Vilayat of Amir al-Mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. And alhamdulillah, the Shias around the world and even the Shia communities in Toronto have done the celebrations in the way it should be done, alhamdulillah. But today, keeping in mind that we also have a funeral of a mu'min, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower his mercy and forgiveness on him, I would like to present to you a very short passage from the khutbah that Amirul Mu'minin gave on a Friday, which happened to be on the day of Ghadir in Kufa. So it was double Eid that day. It was a Friday also and the day of Ghadir. And Amir al-Mu'minin in that khutbah, he says, may Allah shower his blessings upon you on Eidain Kabirain, on two great Eids, the Eid which is known as the day of Juma, as well as the Eid of Ghadir. And he talks about it, inshallah, some other, you know, when the opportunity comes, we'll talk about it. But there is a word section where he is advising us. And that is what I would like to share with you, where he says, فَانْتَبِهُ عَنْ رَقْدَةِ الْغَفْلَةِ. He says, wake up. Wake up from this slumber of carelessness that you are going through. غَفْلَةِ means to be heedless, not to remember the end, not to prepare for the end, which is the akhirah. وَبَادِرُ بِالْعَمَلِ قَبْلَ حُلُولِ الْعَجَلِ. And move quickly to do good deeds before the death comes to you. وَصَابِقُ إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. This is from Surah Hadid, an ayat. And, you know, move forward, move quickly, or even compete. That would be one meaning of the word sabiqu from musabaqa. You know, compete with one another in order to achieve the forgiveness from your Lord. What is our competition? Dollars, house, car, clothes, status, position? The musabiqa in Quran is go and compete against one another in order to get the maghfirat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how do you do that? قَبْلَ أَن يُضْرَبُوا بِالسُّورِ بِبَاطِنِ الرَّحْمَةِ وَظَاهِرِ الْعَظَابِ. Do this. Do this before you are called. Before the trumpet which will announce the end of the world is sounded, which will come in appearance of punishment, but within it there will be rahmah. Because moving towards the akhirah is the symbol of the rahmat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَتُنَادُونَ فَلَا يَسْمَعُوا نِدَاءُكُمْ. When your time will come, your time of death, you will call for help. But nobody will hear. لَا يَسْمَعُوا نِدَاءُ. Nobody will hear your call. وَتَضِجُّونَ فَلَا يُحْفَلُ بِضَجِيجِكُمْ. You will, you know, cry. Ask for help, but nobody will pay attention to your cry. وَقَبْلَ أَن تَسْتَغِيثُوا فَلَا تُغَاسُوا. And be, you know, do good deeds. Compete for the maghfirah before you start asking for help when nobody will be there to help you. سَارِعُوا إِلَى الطَّاعَةَ سَارِعُوا إِلَى الطَّاعَاتِ قَبْلَ فَوْتِ الْأَوْقَاتِ. You know, go quickly towards the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before the time is taken away from you. It's not only the time of death. Whenever the opportunity to do good comes, we should avail it right away. I shouldn't wait that, you know, I'm still young. and a lot of time to do good later on. You don't know when your time will end. Whenever you have the opportunity, whether you are a youth or a young person, you know, just when the opportunity is there, seize that opportunity. You shouldn't wait that maybe, you know, when I'll become more affluent and rich, then I'll do something in charity. Whatever you are able to do it now. You don't know you will have whatever you have even now or not. And so when the time comes, go ahead and do it. Do not delay things, you know, thinking that I'm still healthy and strong. Nobody knows when the time will come, when your wealth will, you know, health will be taken away from you, and you will not be able to do anything. And so whenever the opportunity is there to do the ta'at of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to do the obedience of Allah and to do good deeds, then seize that moment. Don't wait. قَبْلَ فَوْتِ الْأَوْقَاتِ, before the time is taken away from you. فَكَانَ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ حَادِمُ اللَّذَّاتِ, because always you see حَادِمُ اللَّذَّاتِ comes to you. Means that entity, that reality which shatters all the luxuries of this dunya. The Prophet was once asked about it, what is it, hadimul lazzat? He says, when you see the death, that is where you will be reminded of the reality of the akhirah. And that is where we have to keep in mind, فَلَا مَنَاسَ نَجَانٍ وَلَا مَحِيسُ تَخْلِيسٍ, at a time of death when there is no way of escape and there is no way of being delivered from that. عُودُوا رَحِمَكُمُ اللَّهُ بَعْدَ إِنْقِضَاءِ مَجْمَعِكُمْ. Then he says in that gathering of on a Friday of Ghadir, the day of Ghadir in Kufa, he says, today after this prayers, you know, go back to your homes. And what should you do? When he talks about ta'at, when he talks about doing good deeds, now he's specifying only three items from that khutbah. بِالتَّوْسِعَ عَلَىٰ عَيَالِكُمْ, be generous and kind to your family. This is one way of obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and doing good deeds. وَبِالْبِرِّ بِإِخْوَانِكُمْ, and by being good and charitable to the members of your community. So you have the family there, you have the community there. وَالشُّكْرُ لِلَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ عَلَى مَا مَنَحَكُمْ, and always and constantly thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what He has given to you. Not only the material wealth, but even the opportunity to do good. And this is where we see that Amir al-Mu'mineen is reminding us about this issue of seizing the moment before the time is taken away from us. Because death comes without any announcement. Nobody knows where, at what time, at what age. You know, you can sit down and have a long plan, but you know the call can come. And when it comes, nobody knows. And this is where the khutbah of Amir al-Mu'minin on the day of Juma on a Ghadir, you know, emphasizes this point, that seize the moment قبل حلول العجل وقبل فوت الأوقات, before the death comes and before the opportunity and comes to its end. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to fulfill our duty towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to our religion, to the Rasul and the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, and as an extension of that, to our family and our community and the humanity at large. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also give us the tawfiq to always keep this in our mind, that this dunya is a temporary abode, and this is where we get the opportunity to build our akhirah. We will get no chance to build anything there. Akhirah is built only in this dunya. And so let us remember that, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower His blessings upon all of us, especially the marhumin who passed away. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله. وعلى إمام المتقين وأمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه. وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها. وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان. ما حي صار البدوة غيان هذه بيمنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فرو البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.